TitleMatchNetwork.com.
What about Dusty Rhodes, your early memories of Dusty?
Wahoo McDaniels. I never met Dusty. Wahoo McDaniels was out. And the territory was selling out everywhere. I mean, every building was sold out. Ric Flair and Wahoo were just selling everything out. But Wahoo got injured. They couldn't work. So I said, oh man, the building, everybody said, oh, the building's gonna go down, the building's gonna go down. Who is gonna replace Wahoo? Well, Dusty Rhodes came in, and as soon as they mentioned Dusty Rhodes, they had enough people to sell the building out twice. Dusty had to be one of the most talented wrestlers in this business overseas and for his drawing money. You know, he was between entertainment and wrestling. And he was just as popular with the black fans that he were with the whites. In fact, there was a lady in Atlanta that used to always be standing out back with fried chicken and potato salad. So I went up to her one day and I said, hey, is that for the brother? She said, no, this for Dusty. And that's how me and Dusty became friends, because every time that she bring food, I hung around Dusty so I get a piece of that chicken and that potato salad. But Dusty, you know, he's a great guy. And as you can see from his son, Dustin and Goldust, the talent is in the family. Same thing with Ted DiBiase. I mean, when you watch him wrestle, you see Ted Sr. in his younger days. I mean, they even work alike, they walk alike. And the same thing with the Armstrong. You know, when you see one Armstrong, you've seen them all. It's just certain family just got that certain talent that just go from bloodline to bloodline.
You had mentioned Ric Flair. What are your early memories of Flair in this territory?
About the first time I met Ric Flair, he was standing in the hallway with a boner shaking his pecker at some of the other boys. And every time I think of Flair, that's what I remember Flair doing. He was always doing that. Why, I don't know. I don't know why he was shaking himself at guys, you know. But Flair, I remember Ric Flair when Ric Flair was Ric Flair. And if you ever saw him in his heyday, that was the most amazing individual you ever want to see in your life. It was phenomenal to watch him. And it was nothing for him to go 60 minutes a night and go out and drink and go into a bar. And when he leaves out, he picks up everybody's time. You know, he was the guy that walked the walk, talked the talk, tailor-made clothes, jet flying, limousine driving. He was it. He was everything that a wrestler ever dreamed about, you know. You know, he was a Donald Trump before there was a Donald Trump. You know, he was Taj Mahal before there was a Taj Mahal. He was probably the most phenomenal entertainer that this business ever seen.
What about the Briscoes?
The Briscoe was great wrestlers, but not entertaining. Like Flair. I mean, they was outs to heaven. They could out-wrestle Flair all day long, but it was just the charisma and it was just the whole package deal, you know. There were several people in the building like Flair. The first was Gorgeous George, and the next one was Buddy Rogers. And then that came Ric Flair. And there only been three people in this business with that type of, you know. Nick Bockwinkel was pretty classic. He was a pretty classy guy, but nobody, it take in the 70s and 80s, there was nobody close to Ric Flair, not even close, nowhere.
What are your memories of Bob Orton Sr.?
Bob Orton Sr. he didn't talk much to me, because the thing about the old timers, they would only talk to you when you do something wrong. And everybody had their cliques. So you have to kind of earn your spot to hang out with these guys. You know, I hung out a lot with Kevin and Tommy and people of that nature, because we was all new into the business. So you always had a lot of new guys. And once in a while, we hang out with an old timer like Johnny Weaver or Klondike Bill in order for us to learn. But most of the time, it was always cliques, you know. And so I don't have a lot of memories of him, because you know he was nice to me and everything. He gave me advice once in a while, but I wasn't part of his clique.
Did you like wrestling for Georgia Championship Wrestling? Did you like that territory?
Oh, that was the best territory in the world. That was the best territory in the world. We was making anywhere between $1,500 and $2,500 a week. It was home every night.
Right.
And we got laid every night. Every night. Sometimes two or three times a day.
Wow.
We was a bunch of wild kids, you know. Until a lot of us, we ended up getting married, and that slowed a lot of the guys down. Like Tito Santana, he lived a wild life until he met his wife. And then once he met his wife, he was totally faithful to his wife from that day on.
Hmm.
But he met a good woman right off the bat, which was very rare in his business for you to find a woman that would stick with you, and very rare in the business to find a guy that don't cheat on his girl.
From that territory, where did you end up? Was it WWF?
No, first I started in Charlotte, and I went back and forth from Charlotte to Mid-Atlantic, and then sometime I fly out west to Amarillo and other places. And then when I left Georgia Championship Wrestling, I took and went to California. Then when I left California, then I went to WWF.
Who was out in California, Roy Shires?
No, it was a guy, Mike LaBelle.
Mike LaBelle, okay.
Mike LaBelle, because I lived in L.A.
What do you remember working for that territory?
Cheap.
He was cheap as a promoter?
He was cheap. I made most of my money from doing commercials and bodyguards.
Right.
That's where I made most of my money, but it was still fun working for him, though. But I remember he was cheap. And then I left there, I went to WWF. I left WWF, went to AWA, went back to WWF. But once I went up north, I never went back down south.